Well, I just felt that Wycombe came here today and they were quite smug with that sort of Wycombe presence, you know? Unfortunately, that we are Sunderland and this is the Stadium of Light. And when you come to our house, then you have to play by our rules.
I'll light the fire. You place the flowers in the vase.
And welcome back to the ROKER RAPPORT podcast in association with Vaux-Guru, where everything is not great, it's fantastic. We have just decimated the league leaders, well, the former league leaders, Wycombe Wanderers 4-0, in our own house, playing, of course, by our own rules. We were 3-0 up within 21 minutes. And for all the talk of Gareth Ainsworth and his infamous bruiser Wycombe Wanderers side, who you would think would thrive in adverse weather conditions, with players who could kick you about, they did everything wrong and we did everything right. We'll go for the actual review of the match itself. If you have the displeasure of having not seen Sunderland play yesterday, which is normally the opposite of what I say, we lined up with McLaughlin in goal, Willis, Ozturk, Flanagan, 09, Power, Dobson, Hugh, Maguire, Wyke and Gooch. We started off pretty well. A great move from Lyndon Gooch and Denver Hume. Got the ball to Charlie Wyke, who tapped it in from close range to make it 1-0. The second came after a brilliant move down the right flank where we totally just tore Wycombe to pieces with some lovely passing movements. And when we eventually got the ball to Denver Hume, who hit it in from not close range, but he took it first time, kept it low and found the bottom right-hand corner to make it 2-0. It was then 3-0 when the landlord of the Adams Park House, Darius Charles, didn't follow the rule that said that if you bring down a player in the box, he'll give away a penalty, because he did that at Lyndon Gooch and Maguire converted to make it 3-0 in 21 minutes. In the second half, we rounded it all off with a stellar free kick from Maguire again to make it 4-0. So truly, that was a fantastic game. I'm your host, Alex, and I'm joined today by Ant from the ROKER RAPPORT. How are you, Ant?
Yeah, very well. Very well, thank you very much.
Good stuff. I'm also joined by Richard Mennear from The Echo. How are you doing, Richard?
I'm very well, thank you very much.
Good stuff. And I'm also joined by Sky Sports' Keith Downie. How are you doing, Keith?
Yeah, good, thanks. Thanks for having me.
Good stuff, good stuff. So before we jump into the fan questions pertaining to the Wycombe game, let's get some thoughts on that. We'll go to you, Ant. What did you make of the game yesterday?
I thought we were absolutely fantastic. From the first whistle to the last, I thought literally every player was brilliant. I thought the fans were absolutely amazing once again. I think we've really got behind, which is what we all want a bit of unity. We've really got behind the team in recent weeks. And it was just such a nice feeling to come out of the game. I was saying to my dad when we ran away, but I was like, that was just so nice, so good. And like I say, from the first minute we were straight at them. We wouldn't let Wycombe settle into like a rhythm where they were trying to like sort of kick us or anything like that. Couldn't get anywhere near us, could they, really, for the first 20 minutes or so. Scored three of the four goals were excellent goals. Thought Maguire's free kick was absolutely tremendous. Denver Hume, over the moon for him for his first goal. I think he's deserved it, the way he's come on this season. Charlie Wyke as well, he's had a lot of critics in recent weeks as well. Even though we've turned it around, Charlie's still been a little bit poor. I thought he was fantastic up front. Literally cannot fault anything about yesterday at all.
What about you, Richard?
It was the most complete Sunderland performance I think I've seen probably since the end of the Premier League days. Can't remember a better performance in League One. Championship season was pretty much a write-off for most of it. That kind of last week in the Premier League against Everton, you know, under Sam Allardyce, that kind of week. It was probably similar to those kind of performance levels, I think. Lincoln was decent. Well, no, it was better than decent. Lincoln first half was really good last week, but the second half they tailed off quite badly. But yesterday was they were superb from start to finish. They were relentless, and I think the fitness levels have improved dramatically. I think Nick Allenby has had a big impact. Mm-hmm. Phil Parkinson's touched on that a couple of times
in recent
weeks.
Didn't he, in the press conference?
And they just do look fitter, and that then allows them to play that really intense pressing game with 09 and Hume bombing down. It's really a 3-4-3 system, isn't it, with those two playing as wingers for most of the time.
Yeah.
Again, we decide what the formation is based on how well games are going. If we're not playing very well, it's firmly a 5-3-2.
Yeah, well, Gillingham away, that was one of the low points of the season. Yeah. That was firmly a back five.
Oh, yeah.
With De Bock and I think Conor McLaughlin, wasn't it? Oh, 09. But since then, or since Boxing Day, I think Phil Parkinson's had a change in his approach as well. So I think he deserves a lot of credit for the way things have turned around. And now it's about sustaining that.
Can I just interject there, Richard? You said something there about the fitness levels. Yeah. And I've heard quite a lot of people saying that over the last week or two since results have got a bit better.
Yeah.
What was the feeling there? I mean, obviously, I knew Jack quite well. Was the feeling that the players weren't fit enough under him?
I don't think so. Maybe a couple of players, the likes of Chris Maguire and stuff, he's come in for criticism for not being fit enough. And Phil Parkinson's said that he's been doing extra training sessions and stuff like that since he came in. So I wouldn't say there was a general fitness problem under Jack Ross. I just think they just look fitter and they are fitter under Phil Parkinson. Mm. So Nick Allenby's come in as kind of a specialist on that side of things. So I think he's had a big impact. So yeah, I'm not saying they were unfit or anything like that under Jack Ross.
I've heard it from a few people, and I just wondered what.
Because I think under Jack Ross, they didn't really play that pressing kind of game, did they?
No.
Whereas, and to be fair, under Parkinson for the first 10 games or so, they didn't either.
Yeah,
we tried it against Tranmere, didn't we? But the fact that Tranmere were that bad, we just kind of walked through it anyway.
But the last 4 games, there's been a definite sea change, and I think that's the way you'll win promotion out of this league. Mm-hmm.
If under Jack Ross, hypothetically, the lads weren't fit, it might not have shown, really, because I think as many fans criticised him for towards the end of his tenure, he didn't have a very discernible identity. And when we did play, we played very defensively and very cautiously.
I'm a big Jack Ross fan. I think he's an excellent manager and I think he'll have an excellent career. And he's very methodical and he's very well prepared. So I don't for a minute think that the players weren't fit under him.
No.
I just think that the levels have improved under Parkinson.
Yeah. A question here from... I believe, am I saying this right? Helen Fothergill says, we've scored 7 goals in our last 2 league games, as many as we've scored in our previous 9 league matches. Is this a blip in form, or are we finally seeing the team at its full potential, Richard?
Probably the latter. The system suits the plays that he's currently got. I think the back three... I mean, Parkinson's had a couple of 1-1 draws playing the back three, so Jack Ross would have got pelters for that, do you know what I mean? Parkinson was getting heavy criticism, but I think this system suits the current players. Really suits O'Nine and Hume and those kind of wing-back/winger roles. Lyndon Gooch has been excellent since he came back. Chris Maguire looks to have added that consistency over the last 4 games, so you can't really judge that until it's a 10-game period, I wouldn't say. But he's been excellent. His set-piece delivery is brilliant. And Charlie White's made a big impact. Bear in mind that Charlie White got injured in Phil Parkinson's first game at Wycombe and he missed 2 months or so. Six weeks or so. I'm not saying Charlie Wykes a well beater, but he offers that focal point that the likes of Will Grigg doesn't. And when Will Grigg plays, the whole pace of the team slows down. Mm-hmm.
That, just watching that game yesterday, that is how I would imagine a Sunderland supporter wants to see their team play.
Yeah.
That is the best. I mean, when the goals were sort of raining in the first half, I kind of had a glance around and looked at the supporters, and just to see smiles and faces and, you know, them looking happy. Yeah, for a change was just so refreshing. But from kickoff until the final whistle went, I thought the pressing was unbelievable. Mm. Like honestly, and you could go through that entire team from John McLaughlin, who made those two unbelievable saves in injury time, to Charlie Wyke up front. There was nobody in that team, I think, that was less than an 8 out of 10. It was just a complete team performance. And I think what I was most impressed with was at 3-0 up. You could easily, not so much take your foot off the gas, but you could just play out the second half. But what I liked about them is Wycombe, obviously, got a bit of a rocket at halftime. You could see they upped the game a little bit in the second half. And you just dug in there. You just dug in and sort of, I'm not saying weathered the storm because it wasn't that, but I felt like Sunderland almost in the second half, despite the fact they only scored 1 goal, just felt like, you felt like just upped it even more and just got real control of the game in the second half. And I think sometimes, I mean, I'm a Hearts supporter, and I remember when Hearts went in a great run 5, 6, 7 years ago, and we were winning games at home 3-4-0, we were always 3-0 up after 20 minutes, and then you'd get home and you'd be like, oh, it was only 3-0 today because the goals were so early. Do you know what I mean? You were kind of disappointed. And yesterday's game, and I'd imagine the Lincoln game previous to that probably had that feeling. But I just felt, looking at the second half, although you only scored 1 and what a goal it was, just the way you controlled the second half of that match was probably the most impressive thing. Because it's easy. I mean, the amount of energy that must have gone into that first half with the closing down and the work rate off the ball could easily have tailed off in the second half. But I felt like, despite the fact they only scored one, I felt like it went up again towards the end of the match.
There was still that feeling, wasn't there, in the Sunderland team that they had another one or two, possibly three goals in them. I mean, the first
they had
half.
Chances. I mean, they had chances. I mean, they had chances.
I think they didn't shut up shop. That he's clearly settled on his preferred 11, 12 players. So it was unchanged, I think, wasn't he? Yeah, they're unchanged yesterday. And they pretty much played the same team four games in 9 or 10 days over Christmas. Mm-hmm. And that's a testament to the fitness levels again.
That they're playing the same team and again too. And then they had the fitness levels they did yesterday. I thought the two, I know we were talking the whole team were great, but I thought, and the front three were excellent, especially the wide guys, they're closing down. But for me, I felt the two in the middle of the park, like they do a lot of sort of dirty work that goes unnoticed and a couple of unbelievable blocks. And in the kind of attacking third of play, there was one actually near the start of the second half when I think Max Power came in near the dugouts and he put in this sliding sort of challenge, blocked it and played in. I think Gooch and Wyke were through together and they passed up the opportunity, went just wide. But I mean, that was literally a chance out of absolute nothing, out of just his sheer work and endeavour to close it down. I think it was one in the first half as well where Dobson went down, the ball was getting ushered out for a goal kick and he somehow manages to get a touch, like just chased it down, harried, got a touch, won a corner. I'm not sure if that came about one of the goals, but it was round about that period when the goals were going in, and just that work rate off the ball that can sometimes go unnoticed. And you could see, though, although it can sometimes go unnoticed with people watching in the ground, it doesn't go unnoticed with the players, because you could see them after the game really going to those two and saying how good, you know, congratulating them.
And that pressing led to one of the goals yesterday. It led to a couple of the goals against Lincoln. And it's just...
Yeah, it's just that. I think it's that pressure and that positivity, which is, I think, born from having a good mentality of knowing that, you know, we're in a good run here. We're doing well. If we keep this up, we can keep winning. And I suppose as well, a testament again to the fitness, isn't it? But no, yeah, I couldn't agree more with that, Keith. I think seldom is the player who plays the pass before the assist is the one who gets the credit for it. But when you look at players like, especially I think George Dobson, I think in the past few games, he's been, you know, like a really underrated member of that team. He's been a real anchor in the midfield. And yesterday, again, he was instrumental to many of the attacks orchestrated. I think none more so than Denver Hume. And that brings us to a question from Chris Hewitt here, who says, Denver Hume, player of the season so far? And?
Yeah, you can't argue against it, can you? I mean, from the Ipswich game, first away game of the season, he got subbed up at half time. He looked like a lost little boy, didn't he? And he was playing in kind of the same role that he's playing in now. And then you look at him the last few games, he's driving forward, he's beating players really easily, he's got a few assists, he's crossing all season, has improved dramatically. And then yesterday, for a left back, for a young lad, to finish with so much ease and sort of confidence, really, it's just a sentiment to him, and you can tell by his celebration he was over the moon. We were so happy for him as well, and yeah, I mean, I can't really argue with that, really. I think he has been the most consistent player, possibly 09, but you know what you're getting out of 09 anyway. You know, you're going to get 100% out of him. But for someone from the start of the season who looked lost, now looks like a top player in the making, really.
Yeah. I think you get more end product out of Hume as well in terms of crosses and potential assists. And I was pleased he got his goal yesterday. And you mentioned him being hauled off at Ipswich. I think it was Bolton as well. Mm-hmm. Bolton away as well when he was hauled off at half-time. Twice in the first 5 weeks of the season, he was subbed at half-time. So to be fair to him, he's bounced back brilliantly since then. Mm-hmm. For a young lad.
Yeah, I mean, I think Hume and Gooch down that left-hand side, to me, look like two players, and I'm not trying to say you're going to lose them, but they look like two players who could really go through the levels. Like they look like they've got a lot more to give. I mean, I remember seeing Andy Robertson at Liverpool when he was playing for Queen's Park in Scotland in the fourth tier of Scottish football, and you could see he had something in him. And just watching, although obviously Devin Hume's at a higher level than Andy was then, I just watched him yesterday. There was a lot of things that they've really got in common, and you could just see that they're the sort of players, if they get the confidence and they get into a winning sort of mentality, those two players can really go through the levels. Whether that's with Sunderland or someone else, I don't know, but you could see that they can perform at a higher level if they got a number of games under their belt and they're playing at optimum fitness. And they look yesterday, I mean, that certainly, I mean, Gooch to me looked certainly a lot more nimble and quicker and fitter than when I've ever seen him before. Yeah.
I think that Gooch-Hume partnership is also a lot more effective than the Hume-McGeady partnership down that left-hand side.
Yeah, Gooch helps him out a lot more, doesn't he?
He does, yeah.
McGeady just didn't really want to do that work, whereas Gooch literally doesn't stop running. I mean, he walked off yesterday. He looked knackered, didn't he, when he walked off, to be fair to him. He got a standing ovation and everything. But I think the upturn in our form has coincided with him returning. And I think Parkinson has also found his best position for us because he's kind of not playing as like sort of more wide than what he's been used to. He's sort of helping out Wyke a little bit more central, and he's getting in and around the box, and he's a terrier really as well when he's off the ball and trying to get the ball back and stuff like that. And I think he's really improved our performances as well.
Do you know what it looked a bit like yesterday? I've seen a lot of Sheffield United this season, and it actually reminded me of them, like their setup. It was almost identical, the formation, with the two centre-halves sort of splitting and kind of almost like overlapping round the side. I mean, in the first half, Willis, who was playing on the right, I think, of the back three, wasn't he? He was almost like, I mean, I think I think it was him that put the crossover for
you.
And I think he was involved in perhaps involved in one of the other ones as well. But he was just charging forward down the right hand side. I'm not too sure whether Flanagan was so much involved in the left, but it just reminded me of Sheffield United, the way they play. Wycombe almost didn't know what to do with the overload, and every time they went, you just watched either Power or Dobson just drop in and play like a second centre half. And like, I mean, it's not just Championship teams who've struggled with that with Sheffield United. Premier League teams are struggling with that this season as well. We saw West Ham on Friday night there. We've seen a number of teams struggle with that. So, you know, if they can keep doing that and keep improving and the players get used to it, I think teams are really going to struggle against that.
In the press conference, Parkinson touched on that, didn't he? The Willis cross to Hume. And he seemed really pleased in particular with that goal because...
They've been working on it.
You sense they've been working out on the training ground and he's really keen on bodies on the other side of the pitch, getting in the box, etc.
Yeah, that's right. He said you've got a centre-half crossing it and you've got left wing back finishing it off.
Which was his ideal.
Which is exactly what you've seen from Sheffield United over the last couple of years.
So I expect more of that. And Willis, I think second half as well, he was encouraged to get forward a little bit as well. So.
I think that three at the back, I mean, now that we can conclusively call it three at the back, works as a really well as a cohesive unit. For the same reason Chris Wilder's United worked as a really cohesive unit, because when the sort of the wing back or the winger is getting forward, then the centre back who's on that side comes round to provide the cover. And in Jordan Willis, you know, we've got quite a pacey young lad. He's very adept with his feet. He's, you know, he can perform the no-nonsense duty as well. I think we've got players that work quite conveniently in a system that they would never have had at the start of the season, because Ross played a very similar looking, and again, this isn't a really sort of like, you know, chuck dirt at Ross, because, you know, at the same time I do think he was trying to implement something, you know, equally as effective, but I think he went about it possibly wrong, or maybe he was just unfortunate that the lads were not used to it by then.
I think the wing backs under him were more wing backs, whereas they were encouraged to get a bit further forward.
You look at Hume, say, against the Oxford game, first day of the season against Wycombe yesterday, and it's just night and day. Like the way Hume was playing as a wing back is how I would expect McGeady to have played as a winger, which was the fairly predictable, you know, take the ball, run to the byline, swing it in. But if you looked at Hume, and it looked so unnatural when he did that start of the season, because he was running the length of the pitch, he'd get to the byline, the cross would go into the stands. Whereas you look at him now, and, you know, he mainly doubles up with Gooch if he goes down the flank, or he'll cut inside and he'll put the ball through the middle. And he's quite hard to predict, and I think that must be a real nightmare for the average League One defender. You're comparing to McGeady as well, and obviously I'm aware they play different positions, but McGeady, while he was good at what he did, he was very predictable. Like, when he took the ball and he dribbled to the byline, you knew exactly what he was going to try and do. If he wasn't cutting inside, he was going to the byline, he was fainting, then he was moving down and swinging it in.
But also he'll slow the game down as well, because he'll want to take extra touch. I mean, McGeady's still the best player at the club, don't get us wrong, do you know what I mean? Technically, but...
I think it's easier for people to have a little kind of pop at McGeady when he's out of the team. I think it's easy to say, well, that must be the factor because he's out of the team. But you need to remember, 6 weeks ago, you were all saying, you know, he's our best player. Yeah. So you need to. It's very easy to make that judgment. Yeah. I think that's unfair.
I just think maybe we work better without him. I think that's just, we've kind of. I think the proof's in the pudding in the last 4 weeks, because he's not been in and around the team, and we're playing this sort of more quicker, high pressing football. I'm not overly confident McGeady would have been comfortable doing that.
But I mean, as I say, personally, I still think still the best technique.
Oh, undoubtedly. Yeah. If we're going pound to pound on just like sheer quality, I think in the whole league, McGeady will still be your best player in League One. Has to be. But do I think we're working better as a team without him? The way we're playing, I do think so. Because I think the way the human Gooch play on that flank is more effective than having McGeady there for one of them. Mm. And I think obviously a team's more than the sum of its parts. I mean, again, you can't deny that McGeady is a very good footballer, but if he doesn't work in the system, he doesn't work in the system. Yeah. And I think that's what we've found fairly conclusively. Yeah. But
you almost felt when McGeady was in the team, in the games that I saw, you felt that almost like you'd be like, oh, McGeady, you know, he's been the best player today, and then the rest were almost struggling to almost play. I don't know if it was a difference in ability level or whatever, but yesterday to me it looked like a team. It looked like a team, and everyone pulled their weight. The decision making was excellent. It looked like everyone was on the same wavelength. And even in those conditions, I mean, it was so windy in that first half. Mm. It's so easy, and that, and those, when you've got the wind at your back, to just launch it long. And they were playing it on the deck, and a couple of goals came from excellent. When I had maybe like 10-15 passes beforehand, one of the goals in particular, I think it may have been Hume's goal, like the move down the right hand side, and then the finish. Mm-hmm. The passing was unbelievable.
Oh, it was like
and it would have been so easy for them just to launch it long in those conditions, and they didn't.
I think with McGeady as well, is that because he's the best player, they would always look to him.
Yeah.
So then become a bit predictable as well. Yeah. So this system, because it's just more effective, I think. Mm. But Ozturk as well, I think, has been excellent the last month or so.
Oh, absolutely.
He's very simple, keeps it simple, but he's been excellent the last five weeks or so.
I think when you're in League One, it's I think if you're in like any of the lower divisions of the Football League, to do the job of a centre back, just a standard centre back, is quite a basic one. But to do it well is a different story, you know, because you have to. I'm not going to pretend that I have ever been a Football League's centre back, but when you look at what's required to be a good one, you need that positional awareness, the ability to know when to take a pass, to hit it long if need be. You know, when are you no nonsense, when are you not?
Well, there was a lot of that yesterday, wasn't there? Yeah. I mean, there was quite a few times in that first half where they've been under the cosh a bit and they've just lumped it out the box, but they've done it in the right areas. They launched it. I mean, they didn't just launch it for the sake of it, they launched it in the right areas and then played football in the right areas. And I just felt the decision making from the first whistle to the end was absolutely exemplary.
I think there's a difference definitely between, you know, sometimes when you hit it long, you look like a team that is just desperate to get the ball away from danger. Mm. And we've seen that before. But there's also a team that can calculate it, as I think you've alluded to there, Keith. And yeah, I mean, I think Ozturk's been tremendous. All we're waiting for now, Keith, is one of those goals that he scored when he was with Hearts. That's all we're waiting for
well,
now.
Well, that was a good one, wasn't it? Against Hibs, deep in injury time
Were you there for it, or did you see it?
I wasn't there. I think
devastated.
Well, I think I was actually down here at that, but it must have been, what year was that? 2000.
It was a what? It wouldn't
13,
have been
14, something like that. Can't remember.
I think so.
I think I was down here. But yeah, I remember watching the TV and getting a little bit excited.
He just allows our other centre halves as well, who are better footballers than him, to do what they can do. So like you look at Willis setting up the second goal yesterday. He knows he's got a license to do that, because he knows if the ball does break away, then Ozturk is probably the better defender out of three. You know, he does all the dirty work well. So it allows them, if they're comfortable with him doing that, allows them to have, you know, a bit of free rein, really.
I've not seen it back, but I thought Lynch could have gone. His second foul looked like, because he gave the free kick, didn't it? It looked like a yellow.
Didn't look great.
No, but that aside.
If we had to pick faults, you know, that would be I mean, I suppose if we have to pick faults, you would say that Maguire, giving the big in to Ryan Alsop.
You know, yeah, what was all that card about?
I think he just got on his face and he shouted something, but I think the ref gave it as, I mean, he gave it for something. I wasn't close enough to hear what he said, but he said something, you know, as Chris Maguire typically does. But, you know, it's a bit of a straw man argument, but there was that interview from Darius Charles when they beat us 1-0. In the reverse, when he gave the whole speech about our house, our rules, which obviously has really come back to bite him since then.
Yeah.
If you've been on social media in the last, but I don't think it's unreasonable to assume that comments like those have galvanised players like Chris Maguire, who are very vocal and who are very sort of
He loves that side of the game, doesn't he?
He does. Yeah. If he can get a game, and you know, metaphorically speaking, the players by the scruff of the neck.
Yeah.
I think he would. You know, and I think getting a bit of retribution for comments like that is something that he would thrive on. So, you know, it's
part of the game.
It's all right, you know. I don't mind.
I'm glad he wasn't on four yellow cards. Like,
that
would have been a really bad way to miss a game when it's celebrating a goal.
I would. Hey, yeah, that'd have been a bit of a sort of standing on his own toes, we might say. But anyway, another question from Chris Wallace, who says, now that we've played every team in the league, who do you think are our biggest rivals for promotion?
Oh, that's a good question. Out of everybody I've seen, all the home games bar one, haven't particularly been impressed with anyone who's come here, so it's wide open for me. I don't think Coventry would be far away. Coventry look a good side. Rotherham are hitting form at the right time, and Rotherham have got pretty much the same squad as they did got relegated last year, so they'll be there or thereabouts. But I certainly don't think there's anyone that we need to be fearful of. So if we can keep on doing what we're doing and keep on, you know, playing, you know, blowing teams away after half an hour, we won't be far away. But that's the idea for us, is we have to keep it up. I'm sure, you know, we've gone to away teams and people are saying, oh, Sunderland are no good. So, you know, it's wide open. Like I say, there's 6 points between us and first, isn't there? We've got a game in hand. But then if we say if we lose next week, we can go as far down as 11th, I believe. So it's wide open. It's anyone's game. It's going to be really interesting second half of the season, I think.
Right. I think Oxford have made a couple of decent signings early doors in the transfer window. I think they could be potentially dangerous.
But again, I think they've
didn't they get beat yesterday as well, though?
Yeah.
They got beat off Rotherham.
It's a very poor league, which makes it more frustrating why Sunderland are only sixth and were 15th a couple of weeks back, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's quite incredible, really. But I think in a weird way, it's very reassuring. I mean, obviously, Keith, you, as you say, haven't been in many Sunderland games this season. Did you ever have to remind yourself yesterday that the team we were beating 4-0 were the team top of the league?
Yeah, it was strange, wasn't it? Yeah. I mean, as I say, you absolutely can boss that game. I knew Wycombe obviously got off to a strong start to the season, but if I just looked at their form, it wasn't just yesterday. They'd been struggling going into that.
They've lost four and drawn one from the last five.
Yeah. I mean, listen, excuse my ignorance. I didn't recognise too many of their players in terms of when I went through.
That's League One. I don't recognise the team sheet.
Yeah, but I mean, I look at Rotherham and I recognise a few there. I think they've got like a decent squad. I recognise a few in the Doncaster team, but I just looked at their team and other than Akin Fenwa and a couple of others, I didn't really. And that obviously that's a little bit of ignorance on my part, but yeah, I mean, I couldn't believe that Sunderland a couple of weeks ago were what, down in
15th,
yeah. And they were top. I mean, the gulf between the two teams was unbelievable.
Yeah. It just shows the league as well. Like, we have been absolute dog for 3 months, and we've had a good run of form of 4 wins out of 5, and we're suddenly sixth in promotion contention. Yeah. That's how quick it can turn.
There are a lot of teams up there, though, I will say that. And although obviously you're on a good run of form at the moment, there's still, it's not as if there's like just one team away and you're just trying to catch them. There's a lot of teams. And I think I stayed around and listened to Phil Parkinson yesterday, and he was, you know, he was very sort of clear, and he wanted everyone to kind of try and keep their feet on the ground. I think that's important, because you know what it's like being a supporter of Sunderland or any of the teams in the Northeast. It's very easy to kind of get like excited and, you know, we're flying now.
But never far from crisis.
Any
of the clubs.
I mean, football's volatile at the best of times. I think, you know, no more is that true in the Northeast. You look at the league, and I think Parkinson's very right to remind us all that, you know, that we need to keep our feet on the ground. You know, yes, we've put together some good runs, but the league being tight and letting us climb up quickly, that works both ways. If you were to suddenly lose against MK Dons, you know, heaven forbid, you might slide back down again. If other results go against you, you could be back down to 12th. I think the lowest you could possibly go mathematically, we could go back down to 12th. So you know, you've got to keep it up. You know, it's one thing to beat the team top 4-0, but then you've got to keep that form. The teams that win the league, obviously, are the teams that can win week in, week out.
Yeah, you never know what's in the corner. I mean, there might be a takeover here at Sunderland, and then you might be in a bit bother again.
I think we've got a massive game at the end of the month. We're at Portsmouth away, and that's going to be a huge one of where we are. If we can go into there on the same form, they're on the same points as us, we're above them on goal difference, that's going to be where you think, right, are we going to be promotion contenders or are we going to be also runs, I think.
But you know, you'll get injuries. He's obviously named the same team for the last five games, pretty much one or two changes. At some point there'll be injuries. Obviously he's looking to strengthen, and despite the run of form, they absolutely still need four players, I think, and a bit more pace as well.
Oh, definitely. I mean, actually there's something that we'll come to in a second, but I think definitely if you look at the team, a concern that I would have is that, let's say if you played Wycombe on a day where they felt like kicking 10 lumps out of you, because you...
they tried them in the second half, Alex.
Well, let's say that they kicked us in the wrong places and we got Gooch and Hume injured for a month. Suddenly, I think I would be quite worried, because they're two players who've performed admirably in this run that Parkinson's had with that consistently named team. But if you got those two injured, are we confident that, say, Conor McLaughlin could come in and someone else could come in and fill the same role and do the same job?
We definitely need a left-sided player just to cover Hume. Even if it's someone to come and say, right, you're going to be second choice, because, you know, Denver's doing what Denver's doing, really. But we need someone who's naturally left-footed there.
What about that Reece James at Doncaster?
See, I thought you were going to say the Chelsea one.
Oh, well, yeah, that would be nice. You know, that would be nice.
But he's a right back anyway, though, isn't he?
Yeah,
that's true. Yeah. No, oh, well, I guess we can't get him then, you know. But yeah, there's something else as well, I suppose. We may as well mention it while we're on here, but this is the most recent pod since Kyle Lafferty signed for the club, so what do we make of that?
A good sign, I think. I don't think there's too much risk in it, because it's only a 6-month contract, isn't it? He's obviously got a good pedigree, mixed, fully appreciate the mixed goal scoring record and stuff, but he's probably a step up from some of the players I've already got at the club. Loads of experience. I don't think his fitness is too far off. I think he last played the start of December, but Phil Parkinson made the point yesterday that he was training at the academy like yesterday, and he would expect him involved, I don't know, a week or two, I guess. Mm-hmm. So if you get him firing, I think it should be a fairly solid signing.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen Kyle quite a lot up in Scotland. I actually worked at Rangers when he was there for 3 years and obviously saw him at close hand when he was younger. And then more recently, he's been at Hearts, the team I support. So, I mean, I've seen a lot of him over the years. He's 6'4", and I think because of that, people just think big target man, but he's kind of a lanky 6'4". Like, he's almost a couple of inches short of Peter Crouch in terms of but he's a similar sort of player. He's actually, for a big lad, he's actually got a really good touch, holds the ball in well. He's very clever, and he's an excellent finisher. Like, and I'm not just talking about from 6 yards. Like, you know, he'll rattle one in from 25 yards in the top corner. He's a very, very good finisher. However, he is 32. He's never been the quickest, but he's always had that touch, and I think he's still going to have that touch, and he's still going to have that game intelligence. So I don't really think his game will have changed much, because he was never really that quick anyway. However, I'm aware that I think I sat in this exact seat a couple of years ago and said that Dylan McGeoch would be the best player in the was it in League One, wasn't it?
It was in League One.
I thought that because I'd seen how well he'd played in Scotland. Yeah. So, you know, I'm loath to kind of say Lafferty's going to be excellent, but I do think, having watched the team yesterday and know the way Kyle plays, I actually think he would fit him nicely and he'd be an excellent foil for Charlie Wyke.
Well, from what you're saying there, Keith, obviously, if perhaps one of the attributes he lacks is pace, that wouldn't be a concern, I don't imagine, for Parkinson, because you look at Wyke and really the pace in attacking movements is done for him by the likes of Gooch and Hume and Willis, and, you know, players of that ilk.
He's certainly not slow.
No,
but he's not. I mean, he's not. He's kind of big, sort of galloping straight. He's certainly not any slower than Wyke. Say they're probably similar. Sort of, he's probably a better finisher than Wyke, and probably got a better sort of like touch and things. But like, I actually think the two of them could, you know, be a good fall, not playing alongside each other, but just like bring one in, put the other one out. Yeah.
Wyke should have scored more than one goal yesterday.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. And I think that's one thing as well. If I had to criticise him, I would say, I mean, there was that goal, I believe it was in the second half when it came to him in the box. I think there was a move down the side. Again, it was another great move from Dobson and Power to get it there in the first place, but it came to him and he hit, it was maybe 7-6 yards out, and he hit it wide.
Yeah,
I think this is the one that we were alluding to when Power.
That's it. But you look at that and you think, really, I mean, you've scored already, which is great, and we are definitely not going to lose this game. The game does not hinge on you missing that, but it'd be nice if you could have scored it. You know, it's one of those things, and I feel like
he did look better though from the last time I saw him, like weeks ago. He did look a lot better, and he lasted as well.
He did.
And just in terms of Kyle as well, one thing he does is he's a scorer of big goals, and by that I mean important goals. He's won league title deciders up in Scotland, scored them twice that I can remember. Scored the crucial goal that's won the league in an away match. I remember when against Hibs, they had to away from home, a really tough game, last game of the season. The title could have gone to either Celtic or Rangers. They won 1-0. Lafferty scored the goal. He then scored a hat trick against Kilmarnock away in a title win as well, when it was going right down to the wire. And he scored big goals for Hearts. He scored a cracking goal against Celtic 2 years ago when Celtic were on a 69-match unbeaten run and Hearts beat them 4-0.
Right.
And Lafferty was involved in three, scored one unbelievable goal. So he scores important goals. We've seen that with Northern Ireland as well.
Good international record.
I think he's their second highest. 20 goals, yeah, second highest all-time scorer. So he's a scorer of important goals, and he's the kind of guy I would want in my dressing room come the end of the season. If you're up there in the playoff positions or the top two, and you need a win to go through, he's a sort of guy, he's almost just got that lucky sort of element that falls to him in the right place, and he's cool under pressure. So, you know, he might be the kind of guy who, come the business end of the season, might be really, really valuable to you.
I think it's a good sign, especially in 6 months. You can't go.
I mean, so even if it doesn't work, as you say, like it's not going to be an issue that it would hamper the wage bill. It feels like a signing, and obviously, again, I say this because I was another advocate of Dylan McGeoch. I thought Will Grigg was going to be great. But, you know, here's, you know, again, touching wood, I do believe that Lafferty will be a very good fit, because I just feel like he could do the same job as Wyke, potentially a lot better. But again, that's not to have another go at Wyke, because yesterday, again, what I think Wyke does very well, to maybe move it back over to him, is he performs, obviously, the striker's duties well. You know, he got a goal yesterday, he was there in the right place at the right time, but he gets back quite a bit. If you look at, like, I think there was, like, a like not like a heat map, but like a map that we saw of, like, his average position, and it's quite far down for a striker.
Yeah.
So, you know, he gets back.
Does
and,
the work, yeah.
Yeah, he almost sometimes doubles up as his own attacking midfielder, you know, to bring the ball back and then square it to someone who's a bit more technical. So I think for what we've got from him, I think, you know, we're all very satisfied with how well Wyke's playing. A question for you, Keith, from Ross Lawson, who says, what transfer activity does Keith expect us to do this month? Does he think Grigg and McGeady will be Sunderland players the end of the month still because of the wages?
You're probably better asking Richard this one. No, I'm joking, I'm joking. Yeah, I've kind of been out the loop for a little bit. I mean, obviously, I got the nod earlier last week about Lafferty, so we kind of knew that one was happening. It hasn't worked out for Grigg, has it? But I think the issue with Grigg is, are you going to get, unless you're going to loan him out, are you going to get someone who's going to come in and pay similar money to what Sunderland paid for him? And that is it. I mean, it almost makes him really difficult to sell. So I'm not too sure whether, you'll know better than me, Richard, I'm not too sure whether he's going to allow him to go out on loan or not. There's a lot of talk about Liam Boyce as well. I mean, as you know, as a Sunderland supporter, he's pretty good at scoring at the stadium, like he has done. So I think he would be a great signing. Whether that would then allow Grigg to go out on loan, but you have to say, if Boyce was to come in and you've got Grigg, Boyce, Lafferty, Wyke, McNulty,
and what more if you count him?
It's too many. It's too many. So a couple have to go. I got the impression that Parkinson was speaking yesterday that he still wants to bring in an attacker. Now, by that, I don't think, I mean, he's ruled out Gary Medine now because he's got Lafferty. Mm-hmm. So it sounds as though he wants someone to play in a wider area. Having seen Liam Boyce a number of times, I'm not sure. I think he's better through the middle as well. I'm not sure whether you'd play him down the wing. So that for me would make Boyce unlikely, but I don't know. I don't know the ins and outs of that transfer. He also said a central midfielder, didn't he? Or he indicated a central midfielder and obviously a left wing back. So, you know, there could be up to three new signings. Who the identity of those are, I don't know.
I think he'll want a centre back as well. I think Bailey Wright at Bristol City would be a decent signing. There's quite a lot of interest in him.
He was only last season or the season before, played every week, was he not?
Yeah, he's 27, their club captain, but he's out of contract.
He's free
to leave, I think, this month, isn't he? For a fee or whatever.
Yeah.
So he would be a solid, very solid addition, I think.
I just wonder whether looking at it now, and, you know, once Phil's had a look at the way they're playing, whether he might sort of readjust the way he's thinking about it. Does he maybe need to bring in as many as he thought? Because the last thing you want to do is have a bloated first team squad and his people unhappy at not getting a game.
Yeah.
Just in terms of McGeady, you asked about McGeady. I think McGeady will go. I mean, I know from having spoken to him at this stage in his career, he wants to be playing football. Mm-hmm. You know, he's essentially going in and training by himself in the afternoons. I know he's pretty upset about the way it happened. I know obviously the fans were upset about the whole situation and whatnot, but I just think for everyone's sake, it'd be better for him to go and play football. I think he's got a couple of options in the championship, so I would imagine he'll go and
I'd
play there.
So, yeah. And then he would have a lot of the power as well over where he goes.
Yeah,
McGeady.
Yeah,
you would have thought.
I mean, he might have sat there and thought, you know, when things weren't great around about Christmas time when all that happened, he might have sort of been sitting there thinking, you know, if I hang around for a bit, like, it looked as though the manager was, you know, maybe on his last legs, but the manager's now turned things around. He's not going to get McGeady back involved, so McGeady might think now, well, I need to go. Well, he will. He'll think I need to go out and play at his age.
Yeah. I mean, he's 33, isn't he, McGeady?
Yeah, and he wants to play football.
Yeah.
He's very settled in the area, though, so I'm not too sure whether he'll want to move too far. Yeah. So, like, someone like Sheffield Wednesday or Hull or...
Yeah.
You know, I know
there are some very plausible clubs, aren't there? Like, I mean, a club like Hull, for example, would be a very plausible option. You know, it's very close by. It's a division above, but it's not a total light year away in terms of standard. You know, you can imagine them sort of... dropping in and doing a pretty decent job.
I thought Middlesbrough would have made a lot of sense, but they then signed Roberts, didn't they?
I think they're actually looking for another one, though.
Are they, right?
I think Borough makes
a lot of sense.
They need a bit of experience in there as well. So
that wouldn't surprise me.
I would imagine
Robbie Keane link if they get on. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, I think they've got a few plates spinning Middlesbrough, but I think, sorry to coin a Steve Bruce phrase there, but I think he's probably one of them.
Yeah.
In terms of Greg, I think they'll have to take a hit on his, they'll have to pay a fair chunk of his wages to get him.
You're getting nothing more than
nobody's going to pay for Will Grigg what someone would want this, this window.
Or you could keep Will Grigg, sign Liam Boyce and have a Northern Ireland front three with Lafferty.
But I think Boyce would be a really good sign.
I'd like to see Grigg go somewhere, kind of maybe like Rochdale or something like that, and then start scoring goals against our promotion rivals.
Yeah, that's thing that's squarely on my mind. I just think no matter what we do with Grigg, like it is, retrospectively, it's horrendous business because no matter what happens, mate, you're getting nothing more than a loss, are you? You're not gonna break even with Will Grigg. You've got how much you paid for him? I know that it was 4 million plus all the add-ons, but it was I think it was
three million plus, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, look, that's for League One. It's fairly obscene money, and it seemed like a great punt of ambition at the time.
Can you remember the day after deadline day? I remember going out to the stadium late to interview him the next day, and like Netflix were there and everything.
Yeah,
And you know, he was saying he was lying in his pajamas in bed, like when he got the call, and obviously it was a last minute move by Sunderland to get him. They've been trying for so long, but I can vividly remember the next day the excitement and the amount of people who were just messaging me or tweeting me saying, "Will Grigg's on fire!" Like getting so excited about it.
Yeah,
and I can't remember a transfer in a long time that has flopped so badly.
No. Mm-hmm.
You know, given what was expected of him at the time, and you almost feel that there's just been almost a little bit too much water under the bridge now, and he maybe just needs a fresh start. Like his confidence is so low.
He hasn't played a minute for 5 games.
Yeah,
he hasn't brought him off the bench. He's been named on the bench.
Well, that says it all, doesn't it?
Yes, it was an ideal thing to bring him on, wasn't it? And he didn't.
Well,
game was over. Could have brought him on, tried to get him a goal, but
I think Will Grigg said himself he couldn't believe how much Sunderland had paid, didn't he? The week or two after, he was at a fan thing, I think, back at.
Do you not think that's maybe just kind of weighed a little bit heavy on him as well? He's probably thought that, and there was a lot of pressure on him. He's probably put a lot of pressure on himself. But just going back to something you said on Boyce, do you think? I mean, I've watched Boyce quite a bit. Do you think Parkinson thinks about playing him off to the side then? Is that...
Possibly, I think.
Really?
Possibly, I think, yeah.
I haven't seen enough of Liam Boyce. Only time I really see him is when he's scoring against us for Burton.
Just a different option through the middle.
Yeah, because then you've got White, Lafferty and Boyce.
And then
Greg, if you can't get him out. So, I mean, it means you've got... I don't know.
I feel like you're quite oversubscribed up front there, if anything, really. You've got a lot of options for... I don't know. But again, like while I think Greg... You can get rid of him if you're obviously prepared to accept a big loss, but then my fear is that the likely candidate will be a fellow League One club pushing for promotion.
Yeah.
And, you know, what you don't want to do is for him to go somewhere, start banging them in again, and to obviously that will be at the detriment of our promotion push if he did. But
yeah, I'd be surprised if he got himself back up to the Championship after the last year he's had.
Yeah.
Very surprised.
Mm-hmm. I think someone like maybe Wigan will go back in for him again. It's like Wigan are struggling at the bottom of Luton. You know, like
those are probably two of the few that you think. I don't know. The problem is teams are going to look at what's happened to him the last year, and they're going to say we're going to get
shot.
He's
a big gamble.
Yeah, I think for his sake, he probably wants to go somewhere where he's just sort of brought in and then just put straight into the first team just to play. I think any sort of like hype now in another club would be like firmly to his detriment. I just think, you know, and again, perhaps maybe to use. A bit of, not to sound too arrogant looking from a Sunderland perspective, but a smaller club who aren't going to generate as much hype because obviously we really did. You know, I can imagine we brought him in, you know, gets out his PJs, puts some clothes on, comes up to Sunderland, someone puts the Netflix camera in front of him, you know, he's amazed that we've paid 3 million for him. I'd imagine it would be a lot, but... But one question of a different angle. So, obviously, Keith, you're in the studio here today. We have a question from Zach3424, loads of numbers, and he said, Keith dismissed Sunderland last week, citing the fact that we're only a League One club and Sky weren't interested. So, obviously, you said in the reply to that tweet that you'd like to address that on the pod, so by all means.
Yeah, I mean, I thought you might ask that. I think it's fair to say I did kind of sort of dismiss it a little bit. I think... emotions were high at that stage. Obviously, it was the day that the statement came out, the joint fan statement came out. I have to say, not making excuses, but I actually was ill in my sick bed that day. And I was kind of getting badgered, so to speak, by supporters who were sort of, what do you think about this? What do you say about this? What do you think? And like I've said all along, like unless I'm on something like this, or the transfer show on Sky, which I'm on for this month, every Monday, Tuesday, I'm not really sort of here to give my opinion. So very difficult when people are asking you to give your opinion, and at the end of the day, I'm a reporter and I'm not a pundit. So yeah, that was the main reason. And I probably sent a couple of sort of cheeky replies back, because sometimes when you're getting dozens and dozens, sometimes hundreds of sort of comments and replies, it does kind of get on top of you a little bit. But I think what people need to remember is that, and this is the one thing a lot of people have mentioned since then, is we're just a little League One club. You obviously don't report on this. And they've obviously sort of derived that from a couple of things I've said. Now, if you look at any national publication, whether it be newspaper, radio or TV, when a team drops down to the Championship or League One, they don't get as much coverage as a team do in a Premier League. And it's sad the way it is. But it's just the way football's going these days. There's just so much emphasis on the Premier League. And it's certainly with us at Sky as well. I have to try and fight to almost get you on the TV, I think would be a way to say it. Like, if you have a press conference on a Monday with Phil Parkinson or Jack Ross before, you know, quite often I have to say, look, you know, can we go along to Sunderland? And it just depends whether they sort of want to spend the money sending the crew along to do that. And I think that's the same. I mean, Richard, you know, you go to most of the press conferences, there's very few national broadcasters there, unless it's a massive game or there's a big story brewing or anything like that. So I find it hard to kind of get you on. But what I will say is, you name me a team in League One who gets equal or more coverage than what Sunderland does on Sky or any other national platform. You won't find one, okay? So Sunderland still get more coverage than any other League One club. But I think supporters just need to understand that you're not on a national level, you're not going to get the same coverage as you would do if you were a team in the Premier League or even the Championship. I mean, certainly I gave you more coverage in the Championship than I do in League One. I think last season it was a bit of a story because it was your first season down. So again, we probably gave a little bit more. The takeover had just happened. But with it being the second season in League One, the interest on a national level, certainly from my bosses, from my producers, kind of dwindles a little bit. So I find it hard to get on. Now, that doesn't mean I can't talk about it on Twitter or whatever, and I do try to, you know, when I can, but it's just a sad situation, and it's just the way it goes. So yeah, I can understand why fans are saying that, and if I'm honest, I'm sort of disappointed in myself for maybe a couple of my replies, and maybe I should have sort of thought about it a little bit more. So for any supporters who thought I was dismissive, I do apologise for that. I certainly didn't mean to, and I suppose I was just trying to have a little bit of a sort of joke with some of them as well. I didn't probably realise the severity of the situation. I mean, I've not been to that many matches this season. In fact, yesterday was the first match I've been to in a long time, and it was as good an atmosphere as I can remember seeing in my 6.5 years in the Northeast. So, you know, going to the game yesterday, I was like, what's the problem? Why is everyone getting so annoyed? But I understand that on Boxing Day against Bolton in the 0-0 draw, it was completely different. So, yeah. I also, if I'm honest with you, feel that over the last 18 months, we have put out a couple of, shall we say, negative Stuart Donald stories or stories that maybe went against what he was trying to do or what he said he was trying to do. And the couple of times we've done it, I feel like we've been like sort of shouted down. Don't say that about our owner or whatever. He's trying to do the right thing. Like, I'll give you one example, is Josh Madger last January. People were absolutely battering us for us breaking the story about Josh Madger leaving, saying we were causing all the trouble when really it had all been agreed and we were just reporting what was happening. And then even more so in the summer when we put a story out to say that he was in talks with a takeover, the first takeover that fell through. And I was obviously getting a steer from powers that be at the club, Stuart and his people. I was getting steers from them. And then obviously I was then 15, 20 minutes later reading on Twitter or reading on ROKER Rapport interview with Stuart, quotes from Stuart saying that it's absolute rubbish. And so there was real mixed messages coming out. So I felt the warning signs have always been there. I know a lot of other national journalists have written stories similar to that they've tried to say negative things. We feel as a whole that we've kind of have been shouted down. So then when the fans groups team up together to put a statement out like that to say, look, Donald out, Parkinson out, there's a little bit of me that's a bit like, well, hang on, we kind of told you so. But now looking back in the cold light of day thinking about it, it is a big story. It is four fans groups doing that. I mean, I must say, having been at the match yesterday, having listened to Phil Parkinson after the game, having watched the style of football that was played, it all does look a little bit hasty to me. So they've either, everyone's either gone too quick and they've been too hasty, or I tell you what, they've played an absolute blinder. Mm-hmm. And they've actually, in a kind of strange yeah. roundabout way, got everyone together and got the team mm-hmm. playing and got the everyone behind the manager. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's a long answer to answer a pretty short question. But I suppose to just to cap it off, you know, people say, oh, you're a mag, you're a Newcastle fan because you cover them. What we don't. I cover them more because they're in the Premier League. And, you know, you'll know from most other national journalists that work in the Northeast, they're in the exact same position. If Sunderland were in the Premier League and Newcastle were in League One, it would be exactly the same. Mm-hmm. And it's just the way it is. And I think people have to accept that, that if I'm covering Newcastle, it's because I'm told to go there by my bosses, you know.
I suppose as well to sort of go with what you're saying there to cap it off, it can be quite a volatile industry, football as a whole. You know, results can change and fluctuate and emotions correspond with those. So I think that's always the case with things like Twitter exchanges results happen. It's just, I think it's possibly just par for the course and what happens, happens.
Yeah, I mean if we were writing positive Sunderland pieces, I mean even yesterday, like I was at the match, you put a couple of tweets out saying how good the football was, and you get a few mm-hmm. Newcastle fans having a go, and you're like, you literally can't win whatever you do. Yeah. Like you actually can't just say what you see anymore, because mm-hmm. if you say what you see, it means you're affiliated to one side or the other. I mean, as you know, and you can hear it in my accent, I'm Scottish. I'm not a fan of either club. All I want for me in a professional level, and now that I've got so many friends down here who support both Sunderland and Newcastle mm-hmm. and Middlesbrough, all I want is all three teams to do well. And then I don't understand how Joe Bloggs in the street can't understand that. Why you have to pick one or the other? Like, yeah. I actually just want them all. What I would love is all three of them in the Premier League, fighting to win trophies, fighting to get into Europe. But sadly, that's not the case. So you have to just report on what you see in front of you. And let's be honest, until the last few weeks, it's been highly negative for Sunderland. Mm-hmm. It really has, despite apart from a couple of trips out to Wembley. Mm-hmm. The last 4 or 5 years, it's been horrendous. Certainly in the six and a half years I've been down here, it's been pretty dire to report on. And, you know, you can only report on what's in front of you.
So you're essentially saying that you have to report what you see, basically.
Totally,
If you're watching a side lose consecutive games, then that's the nature of what you would report on.
The supporters are the biggest critics, you know. And look at what they did just after Boxing Day with the statements and everyone getting behind, or most of the supporters, I think. I know there's been a bit of a divide, but most of the supporters getting behind this Donald out campaign. So mm-hmm. they're critics as well. So, you know, we're there to do the same, but maybe we aren't to the same level of criticism as what they do. But we need to understand that we can't take sides. We just need to report on what we see in front of us. And, mm-hmm. and for a long time now, it's been really bad for Sunderland. It's not been great for Newcastle either, but they're managing to kind of keep their head above water in the Premier League. So we need to report on it to that effect.
Mm-hmm. We've got one more question before we do the MK Dons prediction and then finish. And this question is about Kevin Phillips. Obviously, there were a lot of chants, and I didn't actually realise, but there were loads of like Super Kev chants from the South Stand through the game, and I wasn't quite sure why, really. Actually, it was because he was there at the stadium watching, so, you know, more fool me. But Josh Dixon says, based on the reaction he got and the reaction he showed to the fans, is it worth getting Kevin Phillips on the coaching staff? Thoughts?
You could certainly do a lot worse. I think he'd been at a fans museum event on the Friday, and I did wonder whether Parkinson knew he was there or not yesterday, because there was 3 loud chants of Super.
I think he knew after about 5 minutes of the game kicking off.
Yeah, because obviously last time they were chanting Super Kev, it was to replace Phil Parkinson. Yeah, and he must be thinking, oh, we're 3-0 up here. There's still chanting for Super Kev.
Well, it could have been very awkward yesterday if you'd lost. Do you know what I mean? At least the team were playing well. Imagine you'd lost and Kevin Phillips was there.
If that was mid-crisis, it could have been pretty nasty.
Yeah. He'd be an excellent addition to the coaching staff. Do I think Parkinson will bring him in, given that a lot of fans wanted him to replace Parkinson? No, I don't.
Mm, yeah.
He'd be a very solid striker coach.
Yeah, I mean, I thought at the time, when Jack Ross went, like all the other fans, I was like, they need to go for Kevin Phillips. Yes, he's not got the experience as a manager, but, and I said it at the time, they needed someone just to come in to try and put smiles on faces just again. That's just what they needed. And whether he's got the experience or not, he's a character, and I can imagine players wanting to play for him, and I thought he would be absolutely ideal. And I felt that Stuart Donald at the time looked a gift horse in the mouth when he was basically offering his services to come in, and he decided to go against that. However, what I'll say is you have to give him credit, because Phil Parkinson looks like he's turning things around, and mm-hmm. fair play to Phil Parkinson. He's been getting abused from everywhere, and he's always done is he's stuck his head down and he's just got on with it. Mm-hmm. You know, a weaker man would have crumbled, but he's really let his work do the talking, and you could never have seen this a few weeks ago. Mm-hmm. But I know you want to talk about Phillips, but just in terms of Parkinson, I felt from the outside looking in, I know the fans were sort of crowing for him to go, or some fans were crowing for him to go a few weeks ago, and that has changed somewhat. For me, you can't bring a manager in October and then not give him the January transfer window. He's got someone else's squad of players there. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter how bad results were, I think you need to see them through to January. Mm-hmm. Now, luckily, there's been obviously some shoots of green before that, and now fans are like, oh, hang on, we maybe trust in bringing players, and they're quite pleased that Lafferty's arrived, whatever, and the turn of form has come just about at the right time. But I must say, you have to praise Parkinson, because when he arrived and he came into his opening press conference, that day, I must admit, I wasn't that impressed. I thought, oh God, this isn't, you know, you kind of just get a feel for someone. Yeah, and I was like, yeah, I don't think this is going to go well here. I really did. Mm-hmm. When he sat there and spoke, I just didn't feel impressed by him at all. But what I will say is, it doesn't really matter whether he impresses us or not. It matters what he does to his players. And and despite the fact you went out all the cups early doors and lost a number of games, that is as complete a performance I've seen in a Sunderland team in a long time. And and he's definitely got them playing for him. Now, Kevin Phillips would have been a great choice to get everyone on board and whatever. Whether he would have had quite the same plan that Parkinson's got, I don't know.
I think just on Parkinson, I think the word from the club was always that he was going to get the January window, but I don't think Parkinson could have complained too much if he had been booted after the Burton game.
I agree.
Tuesday defeat, and then certainly after the Bolton.
Yeah. Draw. I mean, I'm saying this, right? I wasn't at those games, so I didn't see those games. I didn't see how bad they were, so it's probably unfair really for me to.
They really didn't feel like there was any way forward, and then all of a sudden he changed, I think, his philosophy a little bit, and it clicked to Doncaster. And like you say, Keith, huge credit to him for that.
I think to call it a miracle for Parkinson is disrespectful to him, because obviously that's his own volition. He's kept his hand on the wheel, and he's pulled the team round, and it's looking now like we're looking like a team that we wanted to see at the start of the season, and if they play the way they were, they look like a team that could win the league. You know, if they keep playing like that, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. He looked like a different man. When he came into his press conference after the game yesterday, he looked like a different man, didn't he? Yeah. The weight of the world looked like he'd lifted off his shoulders. Well, and I know he still knows there's a lot of work to be done, but he looked like a manager actually with the bit between his teeth, enjoying himself, whereas the couple of press conferences I've been to in weeks previously, he just looked a bit like a beaten man.
I think he still had the Bolton thing in his head for me. I always thought when we had him, I still think he had what happened to Bolton at the back of his mind. And I think since the draw at Boxing Day, it's just kind of went, ugh, and just maybe try to start afresh and just like, right, we're going to try and attack and we're going to try and score more goals than everybody else. Because he's kind of, even though we weren't playing very well, we weren't conceding many goals, so he kind of sorted the defence out. So he said, right, I've got this sorted out now. I'm now going to focus on attack, and I'm going to try and score more goals than everybody else, and that's maybe what's done it. And I think now, as you said, when he first, a couple of his press conferences when he first came in were like, oh dear, you know, he was so like kind of negative. And then looking at him yesterday, they bounced in, didn't he? He was like, his shoulders seem a bit more lifted now, and maybe more confident he's getting, and more confident that we're getting on the pitch. It's starting to show now on the pitch.
I mean, you look, it's a great job at Sunderland, you know what I mean? If anyone can turn the tide at Sunderland, then it's one of the best jobs in English football.
Well, I was looking
yesterday, showed that.
Well, I was looking yesterday, Gareth Ainsworth standing there and Phil Parkinson at 3-0 down, and I'm looking at the two of them and thinking, well, you know, Ainsworth was one of the managers who were targeted. I bet he's kind of looking around just now. The amount of supporters here, the atmosphere in the ground, which was really good yesterday, and looking to his left, 10 yards to his left, and there's Phil Parkinson, who probably wasn't first choice for the job, and standing there, and he must be thinking, hang on, how did this happen?
And
it just shows you how quickly things can change.
I mean, in 4 months' time, you know, a lot of us, I mean, I came on this pod and advocate, I didn't want Parkinson in at all, and I wanted him sacked. One on Twitter said, I want them sacked after the Bolton game. I am more than happy in 4 months' time, if we've achieved promotion, to say that he's proven me wrong, and that's what we want, really. Mm-hmm. You know, all we want at the end of the day is to get promoted.
But it feels now as though progress is being made,
Certainly,
As a fan, you must see that. He already, behind the scenes, clearly had the wheels in motion, despite the fact results weren't great.
Well, it comes back to the whole thing about it being a volatile industry, you know, things can turn on the hinges like that, and I think hindsight's a wonderful thing. Did I want him out 3 weeks ago? Absolutely, I did. You know, after the Bolton game, I was like, wow, this is the League One David Moyes. This guy's got nothing about him. There's no positivity here. But then he turns it around, and I think, you know what? I was completely wrong, and I should have stuck with him. But I think when you're in the moment, when you're watching your team that was in the Premier League 3 years ago plummet to 16th in League One, you can't help but just be totally despondent. But
I think a lot of football is swayed. The vehicle of football operates on the emotions of the fans, and that's never going to change. It's always going to be a thing like that. Again, ultimately, I would much rather see Parkinson succeed than fail. You know, like, I don't care who comes in, you know, within reason. I would want them to succeed as a manager of this club because I love this club and I want to see this club win games of football. But I think ultimately you have to look and you have to just think, yeah, it's a really good job that things have turned around. And if he had been sacked, I wouldn't have begrudged the decision. But obviously, as we are now, it seems like that it would have been the wrong one. But you can never know when you're in the dark.
I think as well, though, I mean, and because obviously, if you take any club out of League One any club out of the Premier League, and then in 2.5 years put them in 15th in League One, you're going to get a reaction. You know, it's not just because it's Sunderland; it's because, you know, we've had 2.5 years of endless misery.
Yeah.
And when we do, you know, we're not a League One club. You know, it's a Premier League stadium, it's a Premier League facilities, it's a Premier League fan base.
Yeah, you expect more, don't you?
Yeah, that's all it was.
It's easy for me to sort of sit there and go, oh, you need to be patient, you need to be patient, but then I'm not going to the games week in, week out.
It's like seeing your team lose to Gillingham 1-0 and your manager being over the moon with a point.
Yeah.
But I think that's it, because I think what the difficulty is, and I think I probably look at other clubs and other teams, and I do the same thing, I think we all do. I think when from the outside looking in, all you have to look at a scenario is logic. You know, if it's not your club and there's no emotional attachment, but when it's Sunderland, when it's our club, you've got logic and emotion and they intertwine, and it can at times obscure your better judgment. Of course it can, and we've all you know, made takes on football that have proven to be retrospectively wrong. But if you'd ask the Sunderland fans what's the best course of action, if all they've got to go on is a manager who's playing seven defenders against Gillingham and he's got them 15th in League One, they're going to want him out. But he's turned it around, and full credit to him, he's doing a really good job now, and we're playing a team that we wanted from the start of the season, from the off. So, you know, do I want Parkinson now? Of course I do, because it's all going right.
What are you calling him? Parkiola?
Parkiola.
One of my mates texted me yesterday the way home for the game. He's like, are you going in to see Parkiola after the game? Yeah. He's like, do you want to come to the pub for a beer? And I was like, no, I'm going to go in and listen to Parkiola.
You can't spell Parkinson without in, so you know, let's have him. But that's the thing. Again, it's a volatile industry. You know, like, every Sunderland fan who wanted him out at the Bolton game is justified in their opinion. If you want him in now, then again, that's totally justified because he's pulled it around. No one saw it coming, but we're all happy that it is what it is.
Very happy to be proved wrong come the end of the season.
Oh, absolutely. I love being proven wrong if it means that my team's doing well. Yeah. You know, like,
just very quickly as well, like, and it doesn't really happen in any other sort of region bar like the Northeast, with how quick we are kind of to judge, kind of that we have really kind of stick up for Newcastle fans as well. All we have really is football. That's our bread and butter, isn't it?
Listen, it's the same in other places. Yeah. I mean, I've obviously told you I'm a Hearts supporter. We've got Daniel Stendel as our manager. He's lost his first four games in charge.
Yeah.
And there were stories up in Scotland. Stendel's lost the dressing room and all this. I'm like, he's only been in Doha for 3 or 4 weeks. He's working with a load of players that he's been given, and they don't suit his style of high press. You know, and suddenly all the fans are like, nah, he's not what. I could see the criticism, I could see what people were saying. Yeah. And in the last game, they drew 1-1 with Aberdeen at home, but they absolutely battered them in the game. It was the last game before they went to break, and you could just see, oh, just quiet, stunned them. Yeah. It's just, listen, people say it, we say it again and again and again. Managers say it all the time. It's a results driven business. If you're winning games of football, everything changes.
Predictions for the MK Dons game, I'll go around the table. Give me a score prediction, give me your scorers. We'll start with you, Richard.
I think Sunderland will narrow victory. Won't be as convincing as previously. I'm going to go 2-1. Maguire again and Lafferty off the bench.
Nice.
Oh, do we have to actually pick the scorers?
Yeah. Hey, if you want.
Oh, dear. No, I'm just looking at MK Don's form as we speak there. So they're unbeaten in four. Yeah. So they're doing all right, but they're doing in 19th. I just feel, having watched Sunderland at the weekend, and okay, I don't have that much to kind of go on, but I just thought the performance was that good. That dressing room, that changing room right now, I'm just going to be desperate for the next game to come around. You know, they're just going to be looking at, they're gone from, you know, this hectic schedule to suddenly like, when's our next game? And I just feel they're going to go into it, you know, just, you could see it even, players didn't want to come off the pitch at the end of the game. They kind of did a little lap of honour. They were almost getting dragged off. They're going to be desperate to go back out there again. Yes, MK Dons are in decent form, but I just think the level of that performance from Sunderland the other day, they'll take into the MK Dons game. I hope and I expect you to go on a decent run now. So I'm gonna take you to win 2-0. No idea who the scorers are, but having watched Maguire at the weekend, you know, he's in form, so I would imagine he'll be amongst the goals. But yeah, I think you'll go there and win that.
And?
Yeah, I think it's quite a strange game for us now because we're going to be going down there expecting to win. You know, I'm expecting us to win next week. I'm going down myself, so I'm really looking forward to it. I think we're playing our hands a little bit that we're at quite a nice stadium. So the players will be, you know, we used to play at Stadium of Light and playing well there. So we're going there.
I'm going to stop you there, Rand. Quite a nice stadium.
Yeah, it's a nice stadium. Yeah, been.
This is all the guy who goes on his summer holidays to
Ayr. It's a
proper football
I've
stadium.
I've never been to MK Dons, but that's one of the highlights I've seen. Sunderland going from Premier League to League One. I've almost ticked off all the 92 in the last in the last few seasons.
You've not been there yet.
Full United as well.
Have you not been?
Never been to MK Dons.
No.
I've
been outside of it, but I've never been in it until next week.
So that's two people in the one room looking forward to going to Milton Keynes.
It's quite astounding, really. But you know, but like
so I'm going down there, like I said, travelling down. So expecting us to win. Hopefully, we can keep up the performance. And I think if we do, we will beat them because we're on paper a better team than them. So I'm going to say 3-0. And I'm going to go Lyndon Gooch, and I'm going to go Charlie Wyke and Chris Maguire with probably another pearl of a free kick.
Oh,
and that's
do.
The first time predicted a win since I've started this podcast. There we go.
Yeah, well, only a good sign because obviously when you predicted the other games before, that was during the bad run. So
yes.
Only a good omen.
It was 1-1s, wasn't it?
It was, yeah, if not worse. But yeah, I'm looking at the MK Dons game. So obviously on the downside, they're in good form. But on the plus side, they're not very good. Like, we've played them early this season, the 19th. They aren't a good team. We are a good team on paper and on form now. So I'm going to say 3-1 win. And I'm probably going to go with, I think, ooh, let's see. I'm going to go for another goal from Hume, 0-9, and then one from Lafferty off the bench.
Yeah.
So, yeah, cool. I'm in pretty good spirits about this one. So, yeah, thank you very much for listening to the pod. As a final mention for today's pod, yesterday's match was the end of an era as George Baker, Sunderland's longest-serving member of staff, retired at the age of 87. After service at the club since 1959, George had been the steward in the players' tunnel since 1959, as I said, and we at the Roker Rapport podcast wish him the very best in his retirement. Thank you very much, as always, to our venue, Sunderland University, for giving us a studio to record in. Thank you very much, and good night.